Welcome. Good afternoon. I'm Julie Scroggins, and I'm the Community Programs Manager West at the Tuberous Sclerosis Alliance and your moderator for this adult session. Before we get started, I have a few housekeeping items to go over quickly. First, everyone's microphones will be muted throughout each speaker's presentation. Questions for the speakers can be submitted via the chat box and will be asked by me at the end of the presentation. We will do our best to answer as many questions as time allows. In addition, all conference sessions are being recorded. The camera setting by default has been turned off for all participants. We encourage you to participate on camera if you feel comfortable doing so, but please keep your camera off if you do not want to be on the recording. Now let's move into our adult session, New Treatment Options for Skin Manifestations in TSC. Our speaker is Dr. Thomas Darling. Dr. Darling is professor and chair of dermatology at Uniformed Services University in Bethesda, Maryland. Tom received his MD and PhD degrees from Duke University. He completed medicine internship at UNC Hospitals and dermatology residency at Duke University. He moved to the DC region in 1994 to complete a research fellowship in the dermatology branch, National Cancer Institute, National Institutes of Health. He has been at USU since 1999, studying hamartoma syndromes, mosaicism, and skin regeneration. Tom has documented previously unknown or underappreciated skin manifestations of tuberous sclerosis complex and Proteus syndrome. In collaboration with Dr. Joel Moss at the NIH, Tom's laboratory identified the tumor cells that initiate skin tumor formation in TSC and paracrine factors secreted by these cells that are important in tumorigenesis. They developed a xenograft model for TSC tumors and conditional knockout model for TSC skin tumors. Together with Dr. David Kwiatkowski, they documented UV signature mutations in facial angiofibromas, promoting a recommendation for good sun protection to potentially reduce the severity of TSC skin disease. They found that TSC skin tumor cells induce hair follicle neogenesis in dermal epidermal composites, leading to studies of skin substitutes and the roles of the TSC genes in wound healing. I'll now turn the program over to Dr. Darling.
Thank you very much, Julie. It's good to be here with everybody, and I will try to share my screen. Can you see my screen there and hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. It's good to thank you so much for inviting me to give this talk, and appreciate the TS Alliance and the LAM Foundation for sponsoring this seminar. As Julie mentioned, I'm at the Uniformed Services University, which is in Bethesda, Maryland. It's right across the street from the NIH, and I've been working with Dr. Joel Moss for years now in studying the skin manifestations of tuberous sclerosis, and I'm pleased to present some of our results from those studies and results from a lot of other individuals. And the last session was so good to see the advances and the emphasis on the participation from so many people. And I just want to express my appreciation for those who have come all the way to the NIH and have been involved in the studies that helped us to find out new things that are helping improve the treatment of tuberous sclerosis. So I just have some disclosures here. I don't have any financial interests or conflicts of interest as I give this talk. These are my opinions alone and do not reflect those of the Uniformed Services University or the Department of Defense. And I just mentioned that the talking about the topical sirolimus, this will be off-label use, and it's not, which means that it's not FDA approved yet. Okay, first I'll briefly talk about the skin manifestations of TSC, which include angiofibromas, fibrocephalic plaque, ungual fibromas, Sjögren patch, and hypomelanotic macules, as well as other skin findings. And the first four of these, the angiofibromas to the Sjögren patch, they're bumps in the skin, benign growths that appear as bumps. And the hypomelanotic macules is kind of a different category. That's just a change in pigmentation, looks like a whitish spot. I don't have time today to go into detail about these. You can read about them in a variety of papers, but just wanted to introduce some of the terms that I'm using. And they're named according to partly based on where they occur. So the angiofibromas are mostly on the face. The fibrocephalic plaque, that means it's on the head. Ungual fibromas, that means it's on the toes or the fingernails. Chagrin patch is on the lower back usually, and hypomelanotic macules, they actually can be anywhere on the body, and when involved, the hair can cause white patches of hair. There's other skin findings that I'll mention later, and in addition to this, I just want to mention that people with tuberous sclerosis also are susceptible to the variety of common skin diseases like warts, acne, eczema, just occur just as in anybody. So the TSC skin changes, they appear at different ages. Very commonly, the hypomelanotic macules will be at birth or shortly thereafter. They may not be as evident as in at birth and may need a Wood's lamp to accentuate their appearance. The angiofibromas often occur around age 3 to 5. And then later on, ungual fibromas are the latest ones to appear, usually in teenage years or after. These skin lesions are very common, eventually occurring in most individuals with TSC, but not all of them. There's wide variation extent. Sometimes there can be minimal skin findings or none, all the way to very seriously involved. The skin lesions are used at arriving in the clinical diagnosis of TSC, so they can be useful. And none of these skin lesions become cancerous. So people with tuberous sclerosis later in life can get skin cancer just like anybody, but none of these TSC skin manifestations become cancer. So what are the problems and why do we treat these? Well, sometimes they bleed with minimal trauma, and this is particularly for the facial angiofibromas. Those often bleed. Sometimes they're painful. This is particularly true for lesions on the feet, the ungual fibromas on the feet. And then they can have adverse effects on appearance and social interactions, and this can be a reason for treatment. So we and others have identified new skin findings over the years, and there's something that we call red comets and splinter hemorrhages, and these occur on the fingernails and toenails, and they just look like these little red streaks that occur on the nails. And they're just dilated blood vessels on the nail bed. And the reason they're important is that they can cause these splinter hemorrhages, which is just a little bit of bleeding below the nail. And splinter hemorrhages can also be an indication for some heart problems, but in TSC, these are not an indication of a heart problem and does not need to be worked up for a heart problem. It's just caused by the dilated capillary there. We found that angiofibromas not only occur on the face, but they can also occur on the nipples. And then this recently described entity called folliculocystic and collagen hamartoma. These are kind of like the Sjögren patch or the fibrocephalic plaque, but they're very large and they sometimes ooze. And so they can be even more of a problem for individuals who get these, but they're less common, but they do occur and they're associated with TSC. So what we've done is mapped out the locations of these lesions. Here's on the fibrocephalic plaques and the Sjögren patches of many, many patients and where they actually occur. The fibrocephalic plaque used to be called forehead plaque, and you can see that many do occur on the forehead, but they also occur on the scalp, on the cheeks, on the neck. So we felt that it was important to expand that name to fibrocephalic plaque to improve the recognition that these can occur anywhere. The Sjögren patch usually occurs on the lower back, but you can see that they can also occur on the mid back, the upper back, and even on the buttocks and the thighs. So it's important to realize that the TSC skin manifestations have this kind of variation in appearance. And one of our goals has been to try to improve physician recognition by talking about the variation and where these appear. Just want to do one slide on mosaic TSC because that's an area of interest of our laboratory. This doesn't have so much to do with the talk today, but it's an important area of increased understanding recently. And it's when there's not all the cells in a person's body have the genetic change, just some of them. And what we found is that mosaic TSC can be mild or indistinguishable from germline disease. And so that's a wide variation in the extent, but and we found that people who have asymmetrical or unilateral facial angiofibromas, that's a marker for mosaicism. So that when you see them on one side of the face, that can be an indication of mosaicism. And patients who have no mutation identified using routine genetic testing, they're often mosaic. So we developed an algorithm to help identification of individuals with mosaic TSC so that these could be evaluated more rapidly. And skin lesions are actually an important part of making the genetic diagnosis in these patients. We can obtain a skin sample and do the genetic testing on those. And this work was done in collaboration with David Kwiatkowski at Harvard. And he and I have this article that's just came out in the fall 2020 TS Alliance Perspective magazine. So if you're interested in this topic, I urge you to go there. Okay, we'll now just cover the first part of my talk, which is about prevention, something that we didn't actually think was a goal in tuberous sclerosis, but now we feel that there are possible ways to help reduce the severity of some of these skin lesions, in particular the angiofibromas. And this work came out of our scientific studies. And so I'm going to go over some of the science just briefly on how angiofibromas form. And I hope this is familiar to many people. This would be a cell with a nucleus with a germline mutation. Let's say it's in the TSC2 gene. And you see there's two chromosomes, a maternal and a paternal chromosome. And there's just one mutation allele. And then the second allele is wild type. And so this cell, pretty much in the skin, behaves mostly normally and doesn't cause the skin lesions. But the skin lesions form, so let's say in an angiofibroma, occurs when there's a spontaneous second hit mutation that inactivates that wild type allele. Well, when we studied these skin lesions and determined the types of mutations that were occurring in the skin, we found that a lot of these mutations were due to, they're called ultraviolet signature mutations, UV signature mutations caused by ultraviolet light. And so that was a surprise because these cells are pretty down deep in the dermis that are causing the tumor. But it gave us a clue that sun exposure may be contributing to the formation of the angiofibromas. And that gave us an indication of a possible new way to prevent the formation of angiofibromas, which is sun protection. Now, obviously, that's not going to block all angiofibromas, but hopefully it will reduce the severity and the number of angiofibromas. And this has now been a part of our recommendations. Dermatologists recommend sun protection anyway, so I'm going to spend the next two slides just talking about sun protection and how do we do that. So limit time in the sun, especially in the midday. Be aware of the UV index. You can just Google this on your phone and find out the UV index for that day in your area. And when it's high, stay out of the sun that day. Look at your shadow. And if your shadow is shorter than you are, you should be seeking shade. If your shadow is longer than the sun's down enough, it's not causing as much damage to your skin, but seek shade when possible. Use a wide-brimmed hat, also sunglasses. Avoid sun lamps and tanning parlors. Definitely in children, that's a cause of skin cancer anyways. And so there's been a reduction in legislation against getting minors into tanning parlors, and that's been all very positive for people's health. Use sun protective clothing, long sleeve shirts, pants. Some clothing is actually geared to protect specifically about UV, and you can find those online. And then finally, sunscreen. So I'll spend the next slide t- talking about the different issues with sunscreens. So you want to use a broad spectrum sunscreen that gives you both UVA and UVB protection. So some sunscreens only give you UVB protection. As I mentioned, these cells that cause the angiofibromas are pretty deep down, and it's really the UVA that penetrates down that deeply. So you want to make sure that your sunscreen says broad spectrum on it. It should be SPF 30 or higher, that's sun protection factor, 30 or higher. You want a product that's water resistant, so it doesn't just come off with sweat or when going in the water. You might want to accompany this with the use of a lip balm that has sunscreen in it. We recommend avoiding sunscreen use in babies younger than 6 months, and in those ages, just protecting from sun exposure. Now, there's been some question about vitamin D, because vitamin D is generated partly through exposure to the sun, but you can maintain adequate vitamin D levels just in your diet, or if necessary, adding dietary supplements. So you do not need sun exposure to have adequate levels of vitamin D. Okay, can we prevent other skin lesions? And there's a possibility that ungual fibromas may be worsened by repeated trauma. And this came up because of just in talking to patients, I found that many of them related a history of closing their finger in the door or something, and then a ungual fibroma came up from that. And then when we mapped out where these are actually occurring, they're much more common on the feet than the hands, and the toes get a lot more damaged than the fingers in general. And they were very common on the fifth toe, and in the fifth toe, you would expect to have not that many lesions because it's such a small toe, but they're most commonly found there. So this made us hypothesize that trauma promotes the growth of these lesions. So we recommend comfortable shoes with room for the toes, try to minimize using high-heeled shoes. And in terms of sport activities, you might want to lean towards sports where the toes are not getting a lot of trauma. Again, we don't have any controlled studies demonstrating this, but if you notice that your child is getting a lot of lesions and it correlates with them being involved in, for example, a sport or their footwear, just be aware of this and try to reduce the trauma to their toes. All right, I'll move on now to the treatment section. And this is the area where there's been so much advance because of the new information discovered about how the TSC genes function and how to counteract the loss of these TSC gene function in the growth of the skin lesions. So there's two general areas of treatment. One is surgical and the other is medical. And the surgical obviously involves scalpel, lasers, electrocautery, it can involve cryotherapy, other different kind of external physical means of treating the lesions. An advantage of surgical therapies is it's very fast, it's done in one day. The outcome is pretty dramatic change. But it does require often multiple treatments. A lot of times they have to be repeated. And the other problem with surgical treatments is the pain involved in it. Sometimes people have to undergo general anesthesia in order to have the surgical treatment. There's scarring and there can be recurrences. So beginning years ago, we were dreaming of a medical therapy that was effective. There wasn't until recently, and this knowledge about the TSC signaling pathway helped us understand that mTOR inhibitors were potentially useful, and these have been demonstrated now over the past several years. It can be applied topically or taken orally and useful for TSC skin tumors. There's gradual improvement, and so it's not as fast as surgery. It's very slow and gradual, but people need continuous treatment, and it can't be stopped because once it's stopped, the lesions can regrow. And there are different side effects with medical treatments as well. Oral treatments have more side effects than topical treatments. And the side effects of oral treatments really limits the treatment of TSC skin lesions to only as like a side benefit when you're treating the internal tumors. The choice of therapy depends a lot on the patient. It depends on why the person is seeking treatment, what type of skin lesion is being treated, depends on the effectiveness of the treatment for that particular size and area, the side effects profile of the treatment that's being proposed, and the ease of use for the individual. So ease of use also would cover also availability of use, physician expertise, especially for certain surgical approaches. And then the timing of therapy, you may be pushed into earlier treatment if there's functional impairment. So if there's difficulty with breathing or bleeding or pain, if the lesion is growing very rapidly, then that would probably prompt more early treatment. And then the age of the person is a very important part of timing therapy. In general, we talk about treating TSC skin changes at an early age, but then there's also the factor if you're using surgical approaches, an older age may allow the person to tolerate it better, undergo just local anesthesia instead of general anesthesia. So these are all factors that are personal factors that need to be discussed with your physician before deciding what treatment is the best for your particular skin manifestations. And I'll be going over just some of these things in particular for each type of skin lesion. So for angiofibromas, a simple way is just shave excision to remove, and particularly the lesions that are on the side of the nose, those can be treated very readily by that. The CO2 laser, also a modality to do the same thing. Vascular laser will treat the red lesions, and the mTOR inhibitor applied either topically or oral, which is the new advance, and I'll be talking quite a bit about that. But I figured that by now, as I go over these therapies, I need to have something that's going to capture people's attention a little bit more, maybe be a little bit more memorable. So I decided to present some of these therapies in light of a piece of cake to show an example of the layers of the skin and how these treatments affect these different layers of the skin. So the frosting on the cake is representative of the epidermis or the top layers of the skin. And then you have blood vessels and dermis. Now, blood vessels are actually throughout the dermis, but I'm showing them here as separate layers of the cake. And then the hypodermis, which is the fat below the skin. So the dermis is what has the collagen in it, and it provides the connective tissue. The blood vessels provides the nutrients for your skin, and the epidermis holds you together and protects the top layers of the skin. Okay, so what's happening in a shagreen patch is there's widening of the dermis and thickening of the collagen deep down. In angiofibromas, you have more blood vessels and more dermis. So that's where the angio component is and the fibroma. That's how they get their name. The hypomelanotic macule is just involving the epidermis. Within the top layer of the skin, there's these melanocytes that are the pigment producing cells. And tuberous sclerosis, these little whitish spots are due to the pigment producing cells not producing as much pigment as they need to. But otherwise the skin is pretty much normal. So let's talk about angiofibroma treatment in light of these different layers and how it affects the different layers of the skin. So the vascular layer is targeting really just the blood vessels. The vascular layer laser is very good because it does not cause scarring, but it's only affecting the vascular laser. So it decreases the redness, but it does little to address the problem of the thickness of the skin, and the bumps will still be there. So the ablative laser actually burns off these top layers of skin. And so it will remove the blood vessels and decrease the thickness of the bump, so make the bump not evident, but also eliminates the epidermis. And so this has to heal afterwards. And this is why it's a little bit more user dependent. You know, you want to go deep enough, but not too deep. If it's not deep enough, the bumps will still be there. If it's too deep, there'll be more scarring. And there's a more prolonged wound healing process after using the ablative laser. This is a very effective treatment, a very useful treatment for the right patient. But it is one that involves more healing after having the treatment. Okay, so topical sirolimus, the drug is applied topically, which is really amazing that this topical application actually gets down into the skin deep enough to result in decrease in the redness and eventually decrease in the thickness of the dermis and normalizing the skin over a period of time. So the good thing about topical treatment is that you're giving the drug just to the area where you need it, and you can get fairly high concentrations of the drug right there. With the oral treatment, it goes into your gut, into your bloodstream, and then it comes into your blood vessels, and then from your blood vessels distributes into the dermis. And it does the same thing. It normalizes the skin over a period of time, but it does have more side effects because instead of just being on your skin, it's going through your whole body. So I'd like to discuss now some of the recent data. These two very important studies, double-blind vehicle-controlled trials that showed the safety and efficacy of topical sirolimus for treating facial angiofibromas by Dr. Kaneda in Japan and Drs. Koenig and Hebert in the United States. So these are very foundational studies on top of many other studies, both open label trials and individual case reports showing the utility of this approach for treating facial angiofibromas. And Dr. Kaneda's group just recently reported the response after 1 to 2.5 years of treatment with topical therapy. Angiofibromas, 78% of them showed either marked or moderate improvement in their appearance. Cephalic plaques, 67%, and hypomelanotic macules, 72% improvement. Not only does it improve the appearance of the skin lesions, but this recent study shows how it improves the person's quality of life. This was 33 patients treated with sirolimus gel for 3 months for facial angiofibromas. And they filled out a short form health survey before starting treatment and at the end. And after 3 months of treatment, the scores for vitality, social function, and mental health were significantly improved compared to before treatment. What are the side effects? Well, the side effects are fairly common, but they're generally mild. They occur in a majority of the patients anyways, but they're mild. There's dry skin at the site of application. There's irritation that can occur at the site of application and the potential for worsening acne. A good thing is that the topical sirolimus does not get into the body very readily. There is detectable levels in the blood in some patients, but it's far lower than occurs when you take the drug orally. So there's several considerations that are still being decided. And I think this is where we need further study. One question is when to start treatment. A general consensus is emerging that starting early is better at a younger age when these lesions are maybe just little flat red spots on the face seems to do quite well. The dose of treatment, you can see all the way from 0.2% to 2% sirolimus, and this is not clear, but this happens with many drugs where the vehicle that you use can change the absorption. So what the drug is in can be affected by what is the compound that it's in. And so 0.2% may be getting in just as well as 2%, depending on what kind of compound it's in. So it's not just the dose, but it's the vehicle. I just want to emphasize that part. The frequency of application, many people you'll see using it once a day, other times twice a day. It's not clear exactly what is the best frequency of application. Duration, it seems like you need to use this for weeks and weeks, months and months. And the improvement that you see after 1 year or after 6 months, if you just stop the treatment, the skin lesions will begin to worsen again. And there have been some studies looking to see, well, can we get by with just once a week, twice a week, three times a week treatment? And that does not seem to be sufficient to maintain the improvement that has been obtained. So you really need to get multiple times, daily treatment in order to maintain the response. There's the issue of cost. A lot of times insurance companies will not cover this. It costs anywhere from at the lowest would be $30 a month up to $300 a month. And so this is another area where advocacy with the TS Alliance and things and with trying to get not only topical medications, but also these surgical approaches covered for treatment is very important. There's other considerations for topical sirolimus. There's the FDA approval process, which is ongoing, but kind of got slowed down by the COVID pandemic now. Others are investigating topical everolimus. So there's a clinical trial opening soon for that in France. So we'll be watching for that. And there's a variety of other trials that are ongoing right now. Okay, oral sirolimus also improves the TSC skin tumors. And I emphasize again that this is in patients who are already taking it for other indications, such as their kidney tumors or for LAM. And it's a very slow and gradual improvement. My impression is that oral treatment gets to the same place as topical treatment, but a little slower. Topical treatment may actually be a little faster response, but eventually you get to the same place. There's studies summarizing the use of everolimus orally and the EXIST 1 and EXIST 2 trials after 4 years of treatment, and the skin lesion response rate overall was about 60 to 70%. Very similar to the response of topical treatment. And then this most recent study, a retrospective study of patients treated for SAGAs and AMLs, the mean age was 20.5 years, and on everolimus there was improvement in the erythema, lesion size, lesion density, and percent involvement. So multiple studies now showing everolimus, sirolimus, both improve facial angiofibromas, kind of a side benefit of treating these internal tumors. Now there's a variety of side effects, and dermatologists now are getting more involved in treating the side effects of oral mTOR inhibitors, perhaps, and the skin lesions themselves. So stomatitis, hypercholesterolemia, acne, aptostomatitis, nasopharyngitis, and some of these can be so severe enough to cause stopping the drug. About 9% of patients withdrew eventually because of an adverse event. Topical sirolimus, it's about 2% of patients stop because of an adverse event. So there you see a difference there. We studied a variety of patients who were on it for sirolimus for a long time. Oral ulcers were very common, acneiform lesions, some leg swelling, and impaired wound healing. Now the impaired wound healing was not severe enough so that it would not allow us to do very simple skin biopsies, but major surgeries, it is a factor and should be stopped for that. But most of these with oral sirolimus are grade 1 or 2, and there's ways to help for these things. So I want to talk about treating the side effects of oral treatment. So these oral ulcers, one thing that's very important, especially at the initiation of therapy, when these oral ulcers most commonly occur, is avoiding hard foods, use a soft toothbrush, be very careful and gentle with the dental hygiene. topical protectants can be applied to the skin when they begin, as soon as they begin. Topical corticosteroids can also be used to reduce the inflammation and the pain, and topical analgesics to reduce the pain. So there are ways to get through these oral ulcers. If they're bad enough, the dose of the medication should be reduced, and if necessary, it has to be stopped. But a lot of times with these kind of measures, you can reduce the dose by about 50%, get through the worst period of time, and then begin to consider increasing the dose back up. Acne is very common, and the treatment should be, it's not the typically large cystic acne, but more like papules and pustules. And so it's treated very readily with some topical benzoyl peroxide, topical tretinoin or Retin-A cream, an oral antibiotic if it's necessary. The antibiotics we use don't really interact with the mTOR inhibitors, but you want to just make sure that the drug is not selected that would interact with the mTOR inhibitor. There's other approaches for treating the angiofibromas. Topical sirolimus combined with calcitriol, that's a vitamin D, seemed to be able to have a little more long-term benefit in this one study. Topical sirolimus combined with laser, and even using the laser to try to help improve the penetration of the topical sirolimus. Topical sirolimus can be combined with surgery as well. And just again, being careful about wound response, wound healing response with laser. There's other treatments as well. There's new drugs, topical medications for rosacea, which causes facial redness. And some of these medications may help the redness. If that's a major issue for angiofibromas. Okay, moving on to fibrous cephalic plaques, Sjögren patch, and ungual fibromas. Topical sirolimus and oral mTOR inhibitor, both useful for these. Surgical excision can be applied, especially for smaller lesions in the right area. Sometimes watchful waiting, just, you know, a Sjögren patch often doesn't cause much trouble. Those can be left see what happens over time. A lot of times they stay the same or become less evident over time. So that's a useful approach. So the Sjögren patch, these lesions are all thick, bumpy areas. And so I wanted to cover a little bit why these are kind of slow to respond compared to the angiofibromas. And since this is Halloween time and I'm seeing a lot of spiders outside on the decorations on the houses, I decided to use a spider to help us understand this. So in a normal appearing skin, you have the spider and the web, the spider representing the fibroblast and the web representing the collagen produced by the fibroblast. So in normal skin, these are in nice harmony. You're producing only the collagen you need to maintain the skin. In a Sjögren patch, these fibroblasts are not very happy. They're stressed and overworked because of the activation of the mTOR signaling pathway, and they're producing just too much collagen. And that causes the thickness and bumpy of the skin. So a person that's on an mTOR inhibitor early on, that fibroblast now is normalized, not producing as much collagen, but the collagen is already there. So this collagen persists for some time, and it really takes years and years of treatment. And after long-term treatment, this collagen begins to normalize as well as the fibroblast. So that gives you just a visual representation of how you can expect these Sjögren patches to respond. They do tend to flatten out, but it takes years and years of treatment because of the collagen. Finally, hypomonadic macules. Sunscreen useful to help prevent the sunburn of these. They're more prone to sunburn. And now we can even use tinted sunscreens, which will have a little bit more of the correct skin tone. Oh, I also forgot to mention when I was discussing skin sunscreens, some of the tinted sunscreens have a little bit of green hue, and that may help reduce the appearance of redness on the face. So that's a good type of sunscreen to use. There's sunless tanning lotions. This is uses usually dihydroxyacetone. It reacts with the outer dead layers of skin and makes a little bit of pigment there. needs to be repeated every 5 to 7 days because, as you know, those top layers are always being replaced from below. Concealing creams, things like Dermablend, other products that are just cosmetic agents to cover the hypomelanic macules that can be used. And now we do have treatment. Topical sirolimus can help, particularly for those that are in cosmetically important areas. And there have been a certain, sometimes these lesions respond quite well and begin to show normal pigmentation over a long period of time. All right, to summarize then in my talk, use good sun protection. It'll help reduce the severity and the of the angiofibromas. We recommend that anyways for people to help reduce their risk of skin cancer and wrinkles later in life. Topical sirolimus for facial angiofibromas, it lessens the need for surgical interventions and makes the skin look quite well, and many people have a very good improvement. And finally, those that are taking a systemic mTOR inhibitor for internal tumors usually see an improvement in their skin lesions. So in conclusion, topical sirolimus creams, tuberous sclerosis complex, which I hope you realize is just meant to be memorable and not scientific, but I'm very pleased to see the advances that have come in large part because of this. To these studies. So I'd like to just thank Dr. Joel Moss, who I've worked with for many, many years at the NIH, and his nurse practitioners, Amanda Jones and Patricia Williams, Xiaowei Li, Jian Wang, current members of my laboratory, and Alex Cartron, as well as other medical students that have worked with me over the years, David Kwiatkowski for the genetic analysis, and a big shout out to the Dermatology Working Group, Drs. Tang, Canada, Hebert, Cowan, Whitman, and Soltani. These individuals, even in my preparation for this talk, have provided very valuable input to me over the years, especially in pediatric patients. Just thank everybody who's come to the NIH for these studies and my funding sources from the Tuberous Sclerosis Alliance, NIH, Dermatology Foundation, Doris Duke Charitable Foundation, and the Congressionally Directed Medical Research Program. So with that, I'll end. Thank you very much, and I'm ready to take any questions.
Wow, thank you, Dr. Darling, for sharing all that helpful information and the study results. We've received some questions from the participants, and I'm going to go ahead and start those now. First question, what is the recommended dose of vitamin D to use as prevention at this time?
Okay, so the vitamin D is not for prevention of the angiofibromas, although in that one study I mentioned, they used a combination of topical sirolimus plus topically applied vitamin D, which seemed to help. So that's the one exception. But what I was mentioning vitamin D as part of, if you do strict sun avoidance, then your vitamin D levels will go down. And this can be supplemented just through diet alone, or if your vitamin D levels are not adequate, then you could, and you can have your vitamin D levels tested, then they can be supplemented. But I would just do that through your physician.
Thank you. The next question, is there any known correlation between rosacea development in TSC patients versus those without TSC?
Oh, that's a great question. So I'll say one thing that I've seen is people who have facial angiofibromas and they're initially mistaken as rosacea or as acne or as warts. That definitely happens. But then there are people who have both acne or rosacea and tuberous sclerosis. And it does seem that there may be some connection there, that certain types of TSC skin lesions may make the acne a little bit more difficult to treat within the area of the angiofibromas, or that the rosacea may be augmented by that. So yeah, that's I have not seen any studies on that, but that's a good question.
Thank you. What is the recommended treatment to prevent the recurrence after surgical procedure for angiofibromas?
Okay, so surgeries can be repeated several times. It does get a little bit more tricky as the skin gets more scarred. But just because you have a recurrence after one surgery doesn't necessarily mean that surgery is not the approach. It may be that the surgery needs to be modified, used in a different way. But having prior surgery would also not eliminate the possibility of using topical sirolimus, or if the person was taking oral mTOR inhibitor as well. Actually, all the avenues are still available to that person.
Thank you. Do you have any thoughts on the generic form of sirolimus in terms of its effectiveness in treatment, as insurance may not cover the name brand?
Right. So the compounding pharmacy is frequently using generic sirolimus in compounding the drug. I'm not actually aware of the differences in the cost on that. So I don't know the particulars of that question.
Okay. And the last question that I have right now in the chat is, what are your thoughts on the role of combined surgical and topical medical treatment for facial angiofibromas?
So there's been, I don't have any personal experience on that, but there have been some studies. They do look promising. I don't think there's enough individuals who have been tested to really conclude whether there's like more risk of poor wound healing or more risk of infection or things like that. Those are things that may occur, but the reason that it may be better, especially like using a fractionated laser with the sirolimus, it may help the sirolimus to penetrate deeper into the skin.
Okay. Another question we just received. Do you recommend using topical cream after surgery?
So if you use topical cream after surgery, I would wait until at least the skin re-epithelializes. And then once the, so that's basically that the skin is reformed on the surface, and it's not like an open wound. And the reason I would wait is just because of that delayed wound healing that I mentioned. And I don't think that the skin lesion is going to grow back in those few days that it takes to re-epithelialize. But then it can be applied. And this may be particularly useful for like the ungual fibromas. This is an area that needs to be studied. But the ungual fibromas, they're pretty resistant to treatment, both orally and topically. And maybe after and then after surgical excision, they often recur. And so doing a good excision and then applying it after the area heals may help reduce the recurrence rate. But that's something that needs to be studied.
Do you recommend dermatology for TSC patients? And what are your thoughts on shaving?
You mean beard shaving? That's a good question. So yeah, shaving can be really difficult because if there's angiofibromas there, that's a great way to cause bleeding. So it may be that people should use, instead of a razor, trimmers to keep their beard short, and being very careful, trying not to traumatize the angiofibromas. And what was the first part again?
The first part of the question was, do you recommend dermatology for TSC patients?
Oh, yeah. Of course, I'm going to recommend dermatology for TSC patients. So I think the most common reasons that dermatologists see TSC patients is they're frequently diagnosed by neurologists. And before, if a patient is not going to be treated with an oral mTOR inhibitor, seeing a dermatologist to get started on topical treatment for angiofibromas, I think is a great idea. Getting an initial visit at least to get instructions about your particular situation, I think is very beneficial. And then if anything changes or new comes up, we always love seeing you back.
Why does Rapamune not work as well on paraungual fibromas?
Well, the periungual fibromas, if you look at the pathology of them, the covering of them really thick. It's like a shield. And I think it's really hard for the medicine to get in. And then when the medicine does get in, the medicine is treating the internal part of it. And so the external part, the epidermal part, is still there and makes up a large proportion of the growth. So even though you're driving away the internal part, the external part stays there.
Thank you. Are compounded formulations really reliable since the dosing of topical creams is not studied?
Yeah, that's a great question. So there's very few studies actually on how well mixed they are and how stable they are. The few studies that there have been, they do look like they're well mixed. They do look like they're fairly stable. But I don't actually have that much concern about that as a factor. If you're finding that there's too much irritation, there's too much skin dryness, then you might want to adjust the percentage that's being used. But actually, it is fairly well controlled product compared to a lot of the other things we're putting on their skin that are completely not controlled.
What are your thoughts on applying topical liquid nitrogen?
So we use cryotherapy liquid nitrogen to treat warts all the time. We use them very commonly in the dermatology office. I think they do shrink, and there's good evidence that they do shrink angiofibromas. You'd want to be careful to have somebody who is experienced in using that so they don't cause a lot of blistering, because if you apply the liquid nitrogen to too long or too deep of a freeze, it can actually cause a blister.
Is sirolimus better, in your opinion, in a gel, cream, or ointment?
I don't have an opinion about that. I would just be so happy to have any one of them FDA approved in this country. And then from there, we'll go and see what's actually better.
Okay. Do the TSC lesions grow in the forehead chin area? I'm not sure.
Yeah, they can be on the chin for sure. Then they can be on the fibrocephalic plaque actually can be anywhere on the head. And that's why we changed it from forehead plaque, because people are just looking for the forehead, but we see them anywhere: nose, cheeks, chin, forehead, scalp.
Great. I'm going to give it just a minute to see if we have any additional questions. It doesn't appear that there are any, so I would just like to say thank you, Dr. Darling. We'll have a break now, and our next track will start at 1:45.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Bye-bye.